Hey guys, welcome back. I'm Ian Laspina, and today we're going to talk about the various ways that plate armor could be decorated. Now, there are a million ways to embellish the surface of plate armor. Books can be written on this topic. So unfortunately, I'm not going to be able to cover all of the different ways that it was done in one short video. So I apologize if I leave out one of the methods that you may have wanted to hear more about. You're also going to notice that I'm going to talk about these methods in one at a time, but it's important to recognize that most of the time they don't occur in isolation, and a lot of these techniques are combined to kind of compound the visual effect. So the first method I want to talk about is covering the armor. And when I say covered armor, I don't mean just throwing a heraldic surcoat on over the armor. I mean literally affixing a textile or leather decorative layer to the surface of the armor itself. Now, aside from decoration, this did serve other purposes as well. It could help protect the armor from the elements. And in many cases, especially with the types of armor being worn in the 14th century, it was a structural element integral to the design of the armor, found on the various styles of pairs of plates and covered torso protection. For the purposes of our discussion today, we're going to talk about more how this lends itself to decoration. Even though very few examples of covered armor survive today, medieval inventories are loaded with examples of these, ranging considerably in quality. Now, for structural purposes, all you really need is a strong fabric layer that can support the armor, allow movement, and basically not fall apart under use. Anything beyond that is for decorative or embellishment purposes, and we see this reflected in the inventories. In the Tower of London armory inventories, lower-end armors are simply covered with a double layer of stout hemp fabric, which makes for a perfectly functional armor. But in order to differentiate, on top of something like that hemp fabric, you might be able to use something a little bit fancier. And as we move up, we see colored fustians being used. And then on the higher end examples, we see these things covered in rich, luxurious fabrics like silk taffeta, various silk velvets, embroidered fabrics, and even cloth of gold. And it's not just reserved for torso protection. The inventories list examples of virtually every component of plate armor that could be covered, from sabatons, cuisses, vam braces, up to the helmet, where one example in the Tower of London armories lists 43 bassinets covered in white leather. Painting the surface of an armor is another great way to decorate it. Like covering it, it provides protective qualities to the metal underneath. It's a very good way to decorate an otherwise unremarkable armor that may not lend itself to some of the fancier ways, and it's more accessible to the people who can't afford the costlier forms of decoration. One of the most famous examples of a munitions-grade armor being painted is the Sallet and the Wallace collection from the beginning of the 16th century. The monster face is applied to the armor with a linseed oil-based paint and has survived incredibly well to the present day. Other well-known examples of painted armors are the family of painted infantry armors of the 16th century that use alternating bands of uncovered metal and black paint to give the armors a very striking look. Paint could also be used to enhance other forms of decoration by providing contrast in the background of gilded etched designs. There's also a lot of evidence suggesting the painting of armors well before the 16th century, but unfortunately very few surviving painted armors exist, and many of the ones that do are problematic. In many cases, it is unclear if the paint is original to the working life of the helmet or if it was done at a later date. Some painted armors were polished clean by dealers and collectors in the 19th century, which is incredibly unfortunate. But again, inventories do list specific armors that were painted, sometimes with things like the Arms of England, which is the case for one particular great helm in the Tower of London armory inventory. Applied decoration is another common way to dress up armor. This was very popular during the 14th century and often takes the form of copper alloy, silvered or gilt metal bands applied to the borders of armor components, usually with small rivets. They survive famously on many of the components of the Kerberg No. 13 harness and on various surviving bassinets of the 14th century. This type of decoration is also found on a lot of surviving pairs of gauntlets. The yellow metal contrasts very well with the rest of the armor and gives it a very rich look. After the 14th century, this falls out of favor in a lot of areas but carries on for a while in England and in Germany. Even by the late 15th century, fine German Gothic armors are utilizing a heavily stylized version of this applied decoration. One of the things that you may have noticed is that the brass or gilt applied borders are themselves frequently embellished with another style of decoration that is engraving. It's not uncommon to see Latin mottos and prayers engraved into the surface of the applied bands, and other common motifs engraved into these bands could be geometric designs, floral designs, and vine work. Engraving is a mechanical process, and although the result is similar to, it is different from etching, which we'll look at later. Engraving involves the use of a sharp tool to actually cut grooves into the surface of the material that's being worked. Its use was not just restricted to the applied borders that we looked at before, but it could also be used directly on the surface of the armor, as is the case with this pair of shoulders from Kerberg, where the integral Bessegues are engraved with bears. Going back to the Gothic armor from earlier, now the style is immediately recognizable in part due to the type of decoration that's commonly used on it. The heavily fluted surfaces and decorative edgework set it apart from other styles of armor. Fluting, which are the embossed ridges along the surface of the plates, do have the secondary benefit of strengthening the plate because it will naturally resist mechanical deformation perpendicular to the direction of the flute, but they are primarily there as a decorative element to the armor, mimicking the pleating in contemporary fashionable civilian attire. The borders of the plates, commonly found on Gothic armor, are adorned with intricately cusped edges and pierced decorations not very dissimilar from what can be observed in Gothic tracery and contemporary architectural design. You'll also observe that these could be further embellished with gilt borders, which brings us to gilding, which is adding gold to the surface of the armor. One of the common processes used to apply gold to a decorative band or directly to the surface of the armor was known as fire gilding. Powdered gold is mixed with mercury to form an amalgam, which is spread like a paste on the surface of the object that you want to decorate. The piece is then heated, and the mercury essentially boils and vaporizes off of the surface, leaving the gold chemically bonded to the underlying metal. This is obviously a toxic process since it can expose the goldsmith to a significant amount of mercury vapor, but it looks damn good. It's also, to my understanding, a more durable and thicker application of gold when compared to modern processes like gold plating. Gilding can be used to accent components of armor, or it can literally be applied to the entire surface of the armor with incredible results at an equally incredible cost, which is kind of the point. It's important to realize, too, that armors like this are not just for show. There are armors out there that were, but this particular armor and many similar ones are intended to be fully functional in tournament and in real warfare. Their design as armors not compromised by the rich decoration and was intended as a statement in both the tournament list and on the field of battle. You'll also notice that a lot of these armors have very intricate inscribed designs on them, similar to engraving. While true engraving was still used later on, by the very end of the 15th century and especially into the 16th century, etching had become very popular. Etching is a chemical process rather than a mechanical process like engraving. Instead of cutting directly into the surface you wish to decorate, as with engraving, you cover the surface with an acid-resistive material like a paint or a wax. You then use a tool like a stylus to draw design into the wax, removing it in the process. In the case of paint, you can actually paint the design directly onto the surface. Then you submerge the piece into a weak acid, and anywhere not protected by that acid-resistive material will be etched, leaving the design in the armor. Sometimes the opposite is done, where the intended design is left intact and the background is etched away instead, leaving the design raised on the surface. Although the process of etching was previously known, the first evidence for its use as decoration on armor is not until the mid to late 15th century. Here's an example of one of the earliest pieces of late 15th century armor to be decorated with an etched design. Into the 16th century, etched decoration and armor would be used to achieve some incredibly intricate designs. One of the benefits of etching over engraving is that you're not immediately committed to the design. You can always fix mistakes in the wax before submersion in the acid, whereas a mistake in engraving is rather permanent. The next style of decoration I'd like to talk about is embossing. Now, embossing is a type of decoration where you hammer the material to produce molded shapes on its surface, giving a kind of sculptured appearance. Now, technically, the fluting used on the Gothic armor we looked at before and other styles of armor like Maximilian armor is a type of embossing, but for this topic, we're more concerned with using embossing to produce decorative figures in relief. Here's an example of a late 15th century German-style breastplate that uses modest embossing to create the appearance of a face on the placard. It wasn't really taken to its ultimate expression until the 16th century, though, where embossing was used to produce incredibly sculpted figures in the surface of the armor, as seen here in these examples from the Negroli workshop of Italy in the 16th century. At a certain point, though, embossing can be counterproductive to the function of armor. The technique itself is more easily done in thinner materials, and it doesn't work very well to shed weapons because of all the places that a blade can catch. It's likely that the highly embossed armors were less adapted for real use than some of the other forms of decoration that didn't affect the function of the armor quite as much. Finally, one of the last methods I want to talk about is one of my personal favorites, and that is thermal bluing. When you heat metals to a certain temperature, they begin to change color. And I'm not talking about when it glows red or white hot. That is a function of thermal radiation and occurs at much higher temperatures than we're concerned with here. The colors we're concerned with today occur at lower temperatures and are actually the result of an oxidation layer forming on the surface of the metal. As you heat metal to a certain temperature range, it begins to form an oxidation layer. The layer gets thicker at different temperatures, and the color it becomes is a function of that thickness. By achieving specific temperature, you can control the thickness of that oxidation layer, and thus the color. This layer remains on the surface of the metal even after it cools down, as long as you don't polish it away. In order to look good, though, the temperature needs to be very even over the entire surface of the material. Uneven heating will result in uneven and splotchy color. From a practical standpoint, the oxidation layer prevents the bad kind of oxidation, rust, from forming on the surface of the armor, but it also looks really good. The most common color achieved using this method is a deep purplish blue with an almost iridescent quality to it. This is an example of a surviving armor of Christian I, Elector of Saxony, from the mid-16th century, where although it shows its age and wear, it's still in pretty good shape and demonstrates the beautiful results it can achieve, especially when combined with some of the other methods that we've discussed. All right, guys, so that was kind of an introduction to some of the major techniques out there used to embellish and decorate armor. Like I said at the beginning of the video, you know, this is only kind of scratching the surface. There's all kinds of other stuff out there, like the use of feather plumage, mantles, torses, crests, damascening, inlays, russeting, all kinds of different stuff that hopefully we can hit on in the future. But I just wanted to hit some of the main ones today. So as always, if you have any questions or comments, please leave those down below. I hope you guys learned something. If you enjoyed the video, please leave a thumbs up. If you haven't subscribed already, please consider doing that too. I'd appreciate it very much. Share the video with friends. All the social media links and stuff like that are down in the description below. And a special thanks to my patrons on Patreon who really make the channel possible. Until the next video, we'll see you then. Bye.